Will Clayton Church of Christ. This is August the 2nd, 2020. And this is our evening message on this Sunday afternoon. How can I know the doctrine of Jesus Christ? How can I know the doctrine of Jesus Christ? I was sitting down talking with some saints, and they had a family member in the hospital, had a serious illness, and they're doing well now. And one of the relatives from another congregation asked, when they said, one of the brothers said, you have to preach truth, the doctrine of Christ. And one brother said, okay, here comes a million-dollar question. He said, what is the doctrine of Christ? He's a member of the church, but he was posing it as a question. He said, because I'm hearing all kind of stuff. And I said, man, I told him, I said, that's a powerful question, man. I said, because I know why. Yeah, he said, yeah, he started laughing. I said, yeah, because you sometimes wonder, do we really know the doctrine of Christ? You hear so much stuff. And you hear brethren not giving the invitation anymore at the end of the message. I heard that way before this COVID thing hit. You hear brethren who have their wife with a position in the church. You know, first lady is a position. They act like, now, yeah, first lady is a position. She's over all the other women. And they letting you know that. And he may act like it's not, but first of what? You know, why you got to even first of what? The first lady of the U.S. is the number one lady. I don't care whether we like whoever in the office or not. She's the number one lady. That's why she got security all around where she go. Nobody else move. Even when you're rich, you still, I don't care how rich you are, you can't afford the Secret Service. That's too many men, too many eyes. You never get, you use all your money up on just security alone. Guys are everywhere. You got a jet, you got your own private jet as big as a jumbo 747. You know, come on, you know, you can't hang with first lady. She's it.
Bunch of resources.
Yeah, that's it. All kind of resources. Amen, brother. You know, unlimited. So what is she first of? This nonsense way of letting you know she first and he first. Because you can't be a first lady without a president as a husband. Hello. Amen. I've been saying that for years. So how do you know the doctrine of Christ? Brethren, my thing when I left the Catholic Church, I didn't leave because I was mad at nobody. No priest ever touched me. I never had a priest ever come up and even suggest anything vile. I didn't even know any kids, and I went to a Catholic school till I was in the 8th grade, that ever came and told me any of the priests that we were affiliated with ever touched or said anything. And children do talk about stuff like that. Yeah, they do. So it wasn't nothing to do with that. They wasn't stealing no money that I knew of. It was just the doctrine was bad. I love the bazaars, the fun and carnivals. The doctrine was bad. So when I started caring about my soul, I saw the doctrine wrong. So when I met my wife, she taught me about the truth. I looked at the tracts. I couldn't believe that I could turn to Revelation 20 and find their point there. And I was like, man, this is the point that they're making. This is right here in the Bible. Because when you read Catholic books, it say anything but what the text says. Oh, come. The paragraph would be a page and be one little small three-line verse that'll prove that point that they're trying to make. So, in pursuit of this, I too began to ask, what is a doctrine of Christ? I mean, if it's so easy to see, see that thou teach no other doctrine, Timothy is told. What is a doctrine? Because I'm hearing different things. I'm hearing a doctrine, what I would call Nicolaitan. And I'm going to label it that because Nicolaitan is generic. We didn't got a specifics. Where the elders run the church, if you have them. They determine if you will even go to church, I'm told. If you can go into a building that you help pay for with your money by giving, you should at least have access to it. I'm told the elders, if they deem worship isn't necessary, it will not happen. If they deem the fire of the word may be watched on television, they speak and it is done. They deem if an evangelist is not qualified, regardless to if he's qualified according to God's word, they give him a pink slip. They take his car back if he has one, ask for the keys of the house. And I'm hearing a trend in most churches of Christ that are saying, there's no need for you to come back here and worship with your family. And I was like, so you're banning him from heaven? Because if the church belonged to the Lord, that would be heaven on earth, the kingdom come down. I would think that the elders would not have authority to ban you from coming to worship. Now, elder just is right here in our building. And I know this brother, Hinson, would not tell a man that, even if he asked him to leave because of teaching false doctrine. He would never tell the evangelist, there's no need for you and your family to come here and worship. Because he's a man of God. He may have to set him down. He may have to set me down if I lose it. But I'm sure Keith would not tell me, hey, you and Francis and Steve, y'all don't come back here and chin no more. I'd be willing to say it on my deathbed. I'd have to hear it out of his mouth to believe it. But that's the doctrine, what I call Nicolaitan. It's something that's not of Christ. And then you have Balaam doctrine that also exists in a lot of Church of Christ, where people are taught to lay with Satan or his children, to lay with their ideas. And so you have a Jezebel doctrine in some churches where the sister either runs the church through her husband or she runs it herself by amount of money she has. I remember one congregation I visited, and the brethren said if something went down there, I'm not going to call her name. She may not even be living anymore. I pray she is. But they say, Sister so-and-so. I said, Sister so-and-so. Out of all the people that you could name a brother. And I remember that sister had some power. As I recall, some things went down at that congregation. Sister had some movement. I was like, that's a must be type of a Jezebel type. Somebody said, well, maybe she's just zealous. Nah, because you wouldn't name a sister like that. Nah. You would say, she gonna go get a brother, but he said she gonna shut it down. That's Jezebel mentality. I'm not saying she was. I'm saying that's a mentality. He was afraid of her, and he was an evangelist. So, wow. I mean, it's just like, it's ridiculous. So, what is the doctrine of Jesus Christ? Look at John 7. See, the thing I found out is when I left the Catholic Church, the only confidence I had, because I'm gonna tell you something. When you're in the Catholic Church, I'll put it to you like this. You have the mentality, depending on the strength of congregation, you don't even go to other buildings. My brothers told me when they were young, they said, man, we didn't go to a Baptist church because that was sinners. I said, y'all thought that? He said, yeah, well, they told me, I'm going to a Baptist church. They're not saved. I said, a lot of people don't understand it depends on who's leading the mentality. Catholics are taught they can change the Bible through the Pope. He can add. It was a sin to litter. The Pope made it a sin. One of the Popes, either this one, no, I'm going to say this. I think it was the one before. He made littering a sin and incorporated in Catholic doctrine. Because of we had a big little push at one time. No littering. Destroying the planet. But see, he says, well, I can do that because Paul and Peter wrote, and they, remember, Peter's the first Pope. That's what they say. But see, they're slick because remember, Paul doesn't have a wife, but he wasn't first. So they say Paul was an apostle. You see that? Did y'all see that switch move? But the guy you should have picked as the Pope would be Paul because he had no wife. But I picked Peter because he preached the first message. It's kind of hard. Plus, they call him the Rock. Ridiculous. So the misinterpretation of Scripture called him the Rock because Christ is the Rock, 1 Corinthians 10. Always has been. I'm going to have to make Peter the first Pope. I want to kick it off right. We'll just make Paul an apostle. That's a slick move. Very well thought out. It's not accidental. So, you have to come up with a mentality when you leave an organization like that with all the power and money it has, a billion plus. You have no other organization that can lay claim that other than the Muslims. But you ever notice how Muslims don't bother Catholics? Have you ever noticed how Muslims don't mess with Rome? And you just see a bunch of guys out there with cartoon looking clothes on with multicolored standard attention. Oh, somebody watching. And somebody been told, man, I'm starting out, you can't finish. Because we can bring, because we got unlimited cash. We got stuff in the Vatican. We could sell and handle y'all. I don't care how much oil you got. You just got to understand the system of sin. Cousins, Leave cousins alone a lot. You know, you just have to watch that. So, you have to say, well, I need doctrine that will keep me from ever going back. Because there's so much money, so much power. You don't know of any elected official in religion that truly can represent a billion people. There's no one Muslim that does that. That's what's different in culture. There's no one Muslim that parades around the world. There is no one because they're so dissected. But when he hit the door, he represents all Catholics, and it is a nation, self-rule, and when he comes, he is respected as a president by all other leaders. I don't care where he go, even if you don't like him. Because he got a bunch of his folks in your own cabinet, maybe even in your own leadership. Because the mind is so sharp, you don't like his religious belief, but you need his help. So, you know, that's my boy up in there in your cabinet. You better be careful. All I got to do is flip a switch on him. It turns his heart against you. Be careful because he's listening to what I say. You need heavy scripture. You need somebody who can say, here is my doctrine. Where no one in the church or out the church can sway you. So, watch Jesus do this. Now, when you see this, you should go, man, these brothers are really putting on some fusion in the Church of Christ. John 7 and verse 15. Now, mind you, this is the people of God, the Jews. They are Christ's own. And he is 100% Jew, as accepted, and he is a son of David through Joseph. He is both the king and the priest. He's equal to Melchizedek, who is the king and priest of Salem, which is ancient Jerusalem. Isn't that amazing? How God consistently said it's always been about the holy city. Always. Even when I picked Shiloh, I knew it was going to swing back around to ancient Jerusalem. Why? Because I made him like Melchizedek, who was the king and the priest. So the king and the priest is going to tell you, you cannot be deceived and think you don't know the doctrine of Christ. It's just, it's impossible. You got to lie to yourself. 7:15, and the Jews marvel, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? What does letters do with? He is speaking as a learned man. And what is the learned information? Not Roman, not Greek, not Medo-Persian, not Chaldean, Babylonian. He's speaking like a guy been trained by the school of the Jews. Of which the Pharisees, Sadducees, and the Herodians got their hand in some kind of way to make sure, watch what you're saying in this school. Jesus answered, see, but they know he has been, they know. See, word get around when you haven't been to school. It gets around. This guy been to school. They don't even like him. He has not sat at the feet of Pharisees. He don't like them, and they don't like him. So they said, how does he have such heavy information about God? Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine. There it is. That's it right now. See, that's the thing I needed to keep me from ever going back to the Catholic Church. Right there. But he has just sent me. So that means when he speaks, he only spoke what was in the Old Testament. Jesus never said one thing against the Old Testament. Not the whole time he was on the earth. And he died. And his testament was, I am the Son of God who Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms spoke of. And then you see new doctrine from Acts to Revelation. That's where you get the new doctrine. So when you hear an individual say, Acts is not a doctrinal book, pity the soul, pray for him because his level of ignorance is high. Because Jesus doesn't start speaking and changing things until Acts. That's when you start to hear different stuff. You see a new way of worship, a new way of being a saved person, not going to the priest. You see priests having to come. That's the doctrine. So the Lord is saying, what I've been saying to you all is not mine. It's from my Father. I brought you to the spiritual part of what does it mean to be an adulterer, a murderer, and all those things. And what I'm going to say is not mine. is my Father's. So the doctrine is very plain. In Matthew 19, Jesus says not one single new word. I don't know why brethren run out like it's something new. Because Jesus says three words, but I say. They think that means new. He just emphasizes. What does the law say? Do not covet your neighbor's wife. That's in the first 10 commandments. He isn't changing anything. You just cannot want somebody else's woman or man. And in his analogies, rarely does he ever use a woman as the catalyst that would divorce. But they were divorcing men just like they're divorcing today. Somebody say women have rights. That's a lie. Let me tell you something. You know what gave you rights? Your daddy and what he left you. That's what gave you rights. Because Moses put that in the law. If your daddy had some stuff and he died and the brothers got their portion and they died, man, I got plenty of money. Abigail got plenty of money. But she run to David. No, don't make women subservient losers. No, they weren't. They've never been that way. That's why Jezebel has power. She's not even the queen of the land. It's the king that's running. She got power. Because her man empowered her. So now, she got clout. She know how to twist his mind. Solomon women ate his lunch. So why could they handle the king like that? Because they knew how to get him. So now see, we have to see, this is what's wrong with not being of God. You don't teach right. Like Brother Frias taught on the radio. Not many be masters. Don't be teachers. Because you when it come out your mouth, the Lord has something to say about it. And saints gonna go, no, that's not even right. So he says, if here's the secret, if any man, that key word any, will do his will, he shall know other doctrine. We can get the invitation literally right now. I'm done. I'm going to give some support scripture. This is it. So if you aren't doing the will of God, how would you know what his will is? If you don't know how to drive a car, how would you drive a car? Stop and think about it now. Stop and think about it. If you drive a car, you know the instruments that's in the car. You know the steering wheel is not for you to go to sleep on. It's for you to hold. You know. See, for somebody to act like, because it says you can't hear without a teacher, that mean they can lie. They know they can't. Because while they're speaking without even a Bible in the picture, just talking at the grocery store, I have ability to hear truth. When people tell you they don't believe that, that's what they're telling you. I know it's true. I don't believe it. I don't believe in it. I'm not denying God said. I'm not fixing to do it. That's what they told Jeremiah. As far as what comes out your mouth, we will do not. We're going to do what comes out of our mouth. And the women rose up and spoke. See, those women rose up. Because when you watch who's speaking, they say, and when we went to church to worship the Queen of Heaven, our man was with us. That was woman talk. The women rose up against Jeremiah. Man, we're not going to do what you say. Please. What come out of our mouth we going to do? Women have never been scared of men like that. I don't know who thought that lie. Whether it be of God or whether I speak myself. So now he's coming with heavy duty, in-depth spiritual information. Taking the word of God deeper than they ever had to take him. Because he's qualified. And they say of him, man, never a man speak like this. Nobody, man, the Pharisees don't teach like this. This guy teaches with authority. Same words he's saying, but he took it deep. And he says, you'll know if you're doing his will. If you're doing God's will, coming to the synagogue, serving, coming three times a year. When Jesus starts speaking, you know, man, that's right. That's right. That guy asked him a very technical question. He said, Master, what's the greatest commandment? When he mentioned love God all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, love your neighbor as yourself, on these two, hang all the laws and the prophets. You can hang them up. It can hold them up. He said, yeah, you said right, Master. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as the same. He knew saying. So now that was a guy doing God's will, but he has to know, is this really the one? Let me ask him a couple of questions. Everybody didn't hate Jesus. Everybody wants to see Jesus dead. everybody wasn't like Nicodemus and Joseph Arimathea in the background loving him at a distance. You know, some people did speak up. The Greeks came and asked Philip, where is he? We want to ask some questions. The Greeks, where is he? Gentile, where he at? We want to talk to him. We want to find out some stuff too. The policeman asked John, what do we do? It's like HPD, Houston Police Department, or Armored Police Department, coming up and asking Brother Javier, so what do we do with the uniform and guns and everything? You know, what do we do to be saved? Man, everybody don't want to go to hell. Some people love the Lord. They just don't know him. At one time, Samuel did not know the Lord. And when he spoke, he didn't know. He said, Eli, you come and say, it's the Lord. The Bible said, that's why I didn't know. He didn't know the Lord. So he said, next time a voice comes, say, yeah, Lord, here I am. And he'll talk to you. So, Jesus said, if you're doing God's will, what you know about God already, if you're doing that, you're going to catch him every time. You're trying to honor your parents, trying to be right with your husband or your wife, trying to raise your kids right, going to work, trying to do right with the boss, but you're going to the wrong church. When you hear Jesus, bam, he got you. I got it. And it ain't looking in the Bible. You acting a fool, got a girlfriend on the side looking at pornography. His words going to fly over your head like a spaceship. Because you're not trying to do right. You're not trying to do right. So he said, this is it's in red too, so there can be no confusion now. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. So that's it. It don't matter how sweet you say it. You can give stories about loved ones and how sorrowful life is. I heard a gospel preacher at a funeral. My goodness. Old preacher too. And he said that, I think at the time he said that, I think all his family was dead at that time. Like everybody's gone. And he said, they say, now that's not a film, you're supposed to be preaching us. They say that if you had a choice, you would have chose to come here anyway. I wouldn't have. Now this is gospel preacher, Church of Christ. Because life is too hard. I'm at the car, that brother. Pray for me, that car. He lost his mind. So you telling us you'd have told God, I don't want to be born. You really mad at God, aren't you? You are angry. See, that's what that is. No, I'm not reading this. Your mouth told me you're mad at God. Because who brought you here? God. You can't be mad at us. We didn't bring you here. Your mama didn't bring you here. She can't unless God say okay. So he mad at God. I wouldn't have want to come. Because it's too hard. Somebody should want to say, brother, we got the message. Go ahead, sit down. We love you. It's time coming. I'm not a member of that, listen, let him take the message over. He got it. Sit down. You want some water? Because you gone. You're done for the day. You're done. You're injured. Your leg broke. We know you want to play. Pick the quarterback up. Put him on the bench. His leg is broke. Hug him. Let him cry on his helmet. Give him a bottle of Gatorade and leave him alone. He's done for the day. He's broken, man. I know why I'm going to tell God I wish I wouldn't have been born. That's ridiculous, please. That's ridiculous. It isn't about this, Kirby. It's like you're mad. You're mad. So you're saying God forced you to come here? See, you're lying. You're mad about something. Not disappointed, mad. Disappointed people don't talk like that. Not judging his heart. You've never heard nobody. When Job is mad at God, what does he say? Curse the day I was born. Let it say that no light coming at that. Curse that day. And it finally oozed out his heart. I just want to ask him why he tested me. I'm looking at the women. I'm this. I'm that. I just want to ask him. What have I done? And the minute God starts, but he stuffed his face with his hands. I shouldn't have said nothing. God said, no, we're not done yet. They're gonna write another two chapters about what I'm going to say. You don't get to question. Well, I did nothing. That good guy you are, and I protected you. Devil challenging you, but you don't get to ask me why I let nothing happen. It's just the way it is, and we have to understand. Brethren will keep you grave, flat foot. If you understand you have one friend on the planet, God, nobody else. So don't get angry if someone's taken from you. Don't get angry if somebody just don't like you. Don't get angry whenever you lose, because you still got God. And when you say something crazy and he gets angry, you're done. Now you're toast. Gatorade, cry on your helmet. It's over for you. The game is over. So, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. It's not in him. The law says it's not in me. I'm speaking nothing but truth. Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keepeth the law? Why go ye about to kill me? Now look at this. See, this is something that needs to be explained. The people answered and said, "Thou hast the devil. Who goeth about to kill thee?" Jesus said unto them, "I have done one work, and you all marvel. Moses therefore gave unto you circumcision, not because it is of Moses." He said it wasn't what some God told him, because like a new thing. No, but of the fathers. And you on the Sabbath day circumcise a man. He said, y'all so crazy about Moses. He said, this wasn't even Moses' thing. This was God said what the fathers did. Write that down and keep doing that. He said, and you will violate the Sabbath day to cut that skin. If a man on a Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken, are you angry at me because I have made a man everywhere whole on the Sabbath day? Judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment. What is he talking about? Let's go to John chapter 5. You got to find this story. This will blow your mind. They lost their mind criticizing Jesus because he heals a guy. John chapter 5 and verse number 1. And after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, that is at Jerusalem by the sheep market of Pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. And these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the wall moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. Some people in here are not even 38 years old. 38 years this guy been sick. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" Kind of an odd question you would think. Man, been there 38 years? Yeah, but the Lord wants to know. You want to be made whole? Sometimes we're in a case and we're getting whooped in it. The law comes the same way. You might have been in jail for 40 years for something you didn't do. The law will come in here and say, you want to get out? You're going to maybe go through this same speech. I've been trying to get a large amount of money. He wants to know one thing. Do you want to get out? Do you still want to get out? Or have you given up? See, that's the way the question is that. Do you want to get out? Do you want to walk again? You want a happy marriage? You want to be a good parent? You want to be a good co-worker? You want to be a good business owner? People been complaining about what you pay them. You want to be a good one? You want workers to come to work every day and be happy? I was like, okay, I'm happy. But you got to do what he says. So now the man is challenged. Then but the man answered, "Sir, I have no man," as his excuse list. And he's right. He says, "When the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I'm coming, another steppeth down before me." Why did he just say, "Yeah"? You ever wonder why the Lord say, "Without be made whole"? Why didn't he go, "Yes"? Because I'm past belief, man. You don't understand, Jesus. Let me break it down to you. So I don't have nobody rolling. I'm on my own. I'm a lone wolf. You know? The water starts stirring. Somebody always beat me in. Why do you just say yeah? I'm not criticizing. I'm saying, but why do you just say yeah? Because I'm beaten. I'm beaten. A lot of times you ask people that, you know. You ask her, you want to be a good husband? Now you don't understand. The woman I'm married to, you got time to sit on, let me tell you. Why do you say yes? I'd love to be a good husband. Because you got a list. That's not this. It's just yes. Do you want to be saved? You know, man, I was in a Baptist church. They lied. Went to the Catholic church. They lied. My uncle, he was a Methodist preacher. He lied. that the Lord said, do you want to be saved, man? That's all. I want to hear none of that. You want me? Yes. And I want to tell you all, yes, I'm ready. I'm ready. So what happens now is, Jesus said, rise, take up thy bed and walk. All they have to do is say, yeah, Jesus said, rise, take up thy bed. You went through that story for nothing. Jesus did not ask him, and this is how we learn. This is in-depth teaching, not because of me, but because of Christ has a thought here. When he asks you, are you willing to be made whole? You want to be. He didn't ask, can you heal yourself? That would have been when you go through the list of why it's not working. If someone says, can you be a better parent? That's when you go through the list. When they ask you, do you want to be a better parent? You go, yes, I would. So it says, immediately the man, as John writes, was made whole, took up his bed and walked. And the same day was the Sabbath. Uh-oh, Jesus is violated. Healing on the Sabbath. Isn't that something? Now that's a problem. It's amazing how brethren make a problem from nothing. Isn't that something? They'll argue about anything and come up with stories and expect you to understand. Verse 10, the Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, it is the Sabbath day. It is unlawful to carry out bed. Okay, now they got a valid point. But they should have asked him, why are you carrying your bed on the Sabbath? Did you get thrown out your house or something? But see, we heartless crooks. It's a Sabbath, man. You're supposed to be carrying no bed. We heartless crooks. We want to know why. He answered and said, he that made me whole, the same said to me, take up thy bed and walk. Then they asked him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed? Well, what's like Jesus to pull off a major syndicate crime? Who told you that? Like investigators. Like Crime Stoppers or something. That's crazy. And he that was healed knew not or wist not who it was. For Jesus had conveyed himself away and a multitude being in that place. And afterward, Jesus finding him in the temple. So Jesus found him in the temple later. Isn't that nice? You know, I love a, you got to love a guy like this. Where did Jesus find him? Not at the club. Not at the whore's house. Not at the drug man. Yeah, they had drug back then. That's what pharmacy deal. Yeah, they had drug. Witches was making drugs like no tomorrow. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's why the Lord had to run them out. That drugs are powerful, man. Get them hot. I might can deal with y'all on this lift a little bit, but man, them drugs, y'all go crazy. Yeah, so they found him at the tavern drinking, falling over, vomiting on the table when they running him out. Found him in the temple, right where they should have found him. Behold, thou made whole, sin no more. That's the worst thing coming. Why didn't Jesus go, oh, it's so good to see you in the Father's house. Blessed be ye, child. No, because the Lord, no, I know you're at church. Watch it, I know you're at church, but make sure you don't sin, because something worse going to happen. Just because you're walking, carrying your bed, and you made it to church, make sure you live it. That's the message. That is the message. What did he do wrong? I'm in a temple, man. I'm not sinning. So the Lord gives him encouragement. Make sure you keep doing right. Because something worse can happen. Other than what? You not being able to walk. You not being able to walk the walk I'm going to show you. So you can walk into heaven. The Lord is helping him. And he's helping us. Verse number 15. Then the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. So see, so, yeah, okay, I know it was Jesus. Yeah, you know. See, the man is, they're not trying to rat fink on the Lord. The Lord didn't tell him, tell no man out here. Just you know, hey, you know. I know it was him and Jesus, yeah. He just told him. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Oh my goodness. You know, if this was a sin, Jesus could not have saved us because he'd have a sin. He couldn't save us. But Jesus answered them. He said, my Father worketh hitherto and I work. See, he said, we never literally been off on the Sabbath, man. Me and my Father always worked. Therefore, for the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath day, that's one strike. Strike two, he said also that God was his father, making himself equal with God. See, they knew the way he said that, they knew he wasn't saying God my father like he's Abraham. For no, they knew the phrase you just said, you making yourself equal to God, like you his son or something, like his son's son. They got it. Now they got that, but they couldn't get the love he was teaching. And the mercy and the grace. You see how? See the hypocrite? The hypocrite come out like a beautiful flower popping up from the ground. So what happens now? Verse 19. Then Jesus answered and said to them, truly, truly, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. He really hitting them not. He hitting them in the mouth like Gibson. So he let them know, man, I do exactly what he do. He showed me what to do. I do just like him. I can do everything he do that he let me do. He showed me to do. That's what he's saying. For the Father loveth the Son and showed him all things that he himself do. And he will show him greater works than these that you may marvel. He says, gonna really, he said, I got some more stuff. I'm really blow your mind. He is taking them to the limit. Taking them to the house and dropping them off. Verse 21. For as the Father raised up the dead and quickened them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Do you hear what the Lord said? He said, man, I can raise. He said, I'm doing some more stuff. But see, this is how you do when people press on you unauthorized. If I do that, my Father showed me. And he showed me things he want me to do. I'm going to do some more stuff that's going to really make y'all shake y'all head. Also, I'm going to raise the dead like him. Boy, he can popping them in the mouth with doctrine. No, man, y'all come challenging me by healing nobody. You don't even know what you're doing. So, that's why they mad. Now let's go back over to John chapter 7. So that's the crime he committed while they want to kill him. And he know their heart. They want to kill him. See, but they got a lie. Say, who seek to kill? But they forgot. Y'all already showed me your heart. When I heal a man, y'all want to kill me. I know what you're trying to do. Verse 25 of John 7:25. Then said some of them of Jerusalem, is not this he whom they seek to kill? So the people, you know, people like, this the guy they've been trying. Now I thought they weren't trying to kill nobody. How would the general populace know y'all trying to kill him? They know. The word got out. They said, this is the one trying to kill. That's sad how God lied and everybody around him know, man, they all trying to kill him. Words out. But Lord, he's speaking boldly. He said, the people say they talking about it. And they say nothing unto him. Do the rulers indeed know that this is the very Christ? So they said, you know, they were trying to kill him. But he said, I'm going to talk, man, he's speaking bold, man. They're not talking about, is he the Christ? They must know. See, they know. I thought y'all were trying to kill him. But they lied to him. Who's trying to kill you? Trying to be slick. Verse 27, how be it? We know this man, whence he is. They say, we know where he from. We know his dad, his mama, brothers and sisters. That's what they're saying. We know it. But when Christ coming, no man know whence he is. They say, so we don't know where Christ comes when the anointed come. Because the doctrine teaching the Old Testament, you're not going to know. That's how they're thinking. But it is specifically taught. He's going to be born of a virgin. He got several names that are powerful. One is, God is with us. So see, they're confused on how we will know him yet not know where he's from. It's just a confused nation. Just like the saints are not and not going to church. Verse 28, then cried Jesus in the temple as he taught, saying, now see, now he gets explicit now. You both know me and you know whence I am. He said, you know where I'm from. And I am not come up myself. He said, you know that. But he that sent me is true, whom you know not. He said, that's the problem. He said, that's the problem. You don't know him. You don't know the Father. That's the problem. See, and that's the explanation of we don't know where he's from. That's why I said, now tell you know why? Because they didn't know God. So that's why they say, well, you know where he's taught. We're not going to know. Yeah, because you don't know God. That's why. And since you don't know God, you only think where he's from is mom and daddy. We don't realize he's from Lord. See, that's the in-depth teaching. You're not doing his will, and that's why you do not know and are secure in your heart if what I'm saying is true. Is it okay to be gay? That's the big question of the day. I don't judge gay people. I don't judge nobody. Jesus said he judged, just tearing up scriptures. But let me share something with you about being not a man or a woman. Let me share something with you. Life doesn't function like that. Somebody say, oh, Zion, you talk a lot about homosexuals. Yes, I love them. I have compassion on them. They are human beings. They are my physical brothers and sisters. But they are heathens. And they go against God. And they know what they're doing. So, I got to teach. When you go to the restroom, it's got several identification marks. M for men, W, sometimes a little dress cut out, straight leg thing. Well, women wear pants, but most of you know, okay, man, no matter what country you go to, they may have it in their language written in there. If they got a thing look like a dress, you all know. You can't speak no language with nobody, but you know which one to go to. The dress thing, that's not mine. If I'm like, I'm going to this one. There's only two. Now somebody said, well, why can't we just have it open? But that's fine. The problem with having it open, it's not a big issue. Nobody's worried about being raped. Most people are going to go in with their kid anyway. The problem is that when you go in, you have to remember, there are males that have urinals. You understand? That's why the Bible says we piss against the wall. So for us to use a restroom, you can't have no women there because it isn't going to affect the brother. The male, when he sees a guy accidentally coming to your own girl, he's like, ooh, child, no. But a woman, yeah, I can see her cover your nakedness. That's the problem. That's your problem. So we need some secure post. So if you're going to make stalls for everybody, that's fine. Just say anybody room. That's fine. But just have stalls. Nobody's scared of that. But you still a woman. That's the problem. And so don't make yourself a man. You know why it's important and the ridiculous foolishness of homosexuality? Why it's talked about in Romans 1? It goes against nature. You know why? Somebody comes up and busts your grandmother in the head with a stick. Slaps her, snatches her rings off, and takes her purse. On the way I see she got a gold chain from grandpa, snatches it off her neck, cut her neck, and they run. And as they run, somebody says, an individual robbed. We don't say genders. We don't say genders. What are we looking for? An individual. The hair was black. Were they strong? I don't know. They had a jacket on. Did they sound like a woman? We don't say genders. See, it's getting real stupid now, isn't it? I know, off the chain stupid. How the voice sound? Well, you can't tell by voice because we don't say genders. Were they pregnant? What's I got to do with it? What do you want out there pregnant? Well, still can't tell because it could be a woman trying to look like a dude with a big mustache and muscles. Y'all know that guy, right? And she's pregnant. Still don't know what it is. Might not be a real stone. Might be a thing stuck on there. We don't say gender. See, it's getting so stupid. And you got some movie stars before COVID that was teaching. And we're not going to give our child a gender title. That's fine. But COVID got everybody nervous. Now, you know how you do a person like that when they come up, you know, and they start talking. Say, well, she. Say, oh, my baby, don't say gender. Because I saw your newsletter. Don't say gender. I saw you in choir. Don't say gender. Mm-mm. But it's different. Man, oh, we don't care if no man or woman. They're all bodies are body. We're just going to do some stuff to them and get them up out of here. See, how stupid. It's stupid. So we need to know, did you used to be a dude and now you got some cuts on you? Because we know what we're dealing with here. Because this the doc. See, they tell the doctor everything. And that's something. I won't tell the preacher nothing. Won't tell the saint, no, won't tell the elder, won't tell the deacon. Won't tell mom and dad sometimes nothing. The doctor come, he gonna look, he may even know. Are you born with both or did you get a cut? I'm going to talk to you. Come on now. Come on with it because we got to know. It's some difference in you, whether you have knowledge or not. And certain diseases bother women that don't bother men. What are you? Don't play with me. Because some of these doctors say, look, I can't help you. That close the thing. That you like, I can't help you. You're going to get another doctor. You can't sue him. You don't have to serve you. You're not sick. You're not done. There's not no EMS. You get out of my office. I don't have to serve you. It has nothing to do with your race. I don't want to deal with you because you want to ask my question. I asked you if you're a woman. Now you need to come on with it. I need to know. And Gibson's medicine, he knows. See, see, so you got to tell the homosexual community, you know, y'all need to stop. Y'all need to stop. Cause you when you get to that doctor, you let it all hang out. Like a woman take off a scrunchie, you know, my hair is all the way down to my back. You know, don't lie, cause he can't help you. Cause it's certain diseases that men don't even talk about. A certain disease that women don't even talk about concerning the opposite gender. It's ridiculous. It's a bunch of lies, nonsense, and that's why you got people dying now, because God is tired of people lying. So, now we understand here that we need to recognize Jesus will not accept sin. Or I thought that I don't know the doctrine. I really can't tell. He says it's because you don't know my Father. That's why you're acting crazy with me. Verse 29, but I know him, for I am from him, and he had sent me. Verse 30, then sought they to take him. Now, yeah, really, okay, since you know we're trying to kill, we're going to get you now. But no man laid hands on him, because his hour is now yet come. See, what happens is the mind couldn't reason. We need to get him. I said, well, we need to get him. I don't know, man. I know there's a lot going on. People looking around. I don't know. That's all up. The mind can't function. See, y'all, God won't let your mind function right. Henry was telling us about God allowing you to have a mental instability disease take you over, calling you being unstable like Nebuchadnezzar. Some people, you ever saw people lose their mind for a little while and you see them 2-3 years later and they okay? You need to just think back of what they was doing before it happened. You go, man, he ain't got it loose. And then after that, he lost it. He was in the hospital. I'm not talking about for sickness. Up here. He was okay when I saw him at Kroger's last week. And that's why he got there. See, because the Lord said, okay, since you're going to act like you don't have to answer to me, I'm going to let people laugh at you for a minute. Now, you're going to wear pajamas all day and eat pudding and paint pictures. And big guys, Gibson will tell you about it, will come in with muscles, and they say, okay, let's move to the left side of the room, and you move to, and then big muscles walk toward you, and you move with your pajamas to the left side of the room, because you know, now he got a family, he want to get back home, he will body slam me. That's Gibson, he used to work in the pump. I'm only crazy till your muscles get bigger than mine. That's when I get my mind back. See, the little woman, 130 pounds, I acted a fool with her. But 250, Gibson, muscles, lifting weights all day, plenty of iron in his life. He walks in with authority. Hey, man, you going to come and whoop me? I told you, go to outside the room. Man, y'all saw me. Yeah, but you went. Because you know that's going to be drama in your life, not theirs. See, all of a sudden, intelligence is running rapid in your life. Isn't that amazing? But you was acting a fool before Gibson came to work and clocked in. Isn't that amazing? Ask him about it. He'll tell you about it. Makes you wonder. Fine, as we wrap up. The will of God is to heal and comfort the brokenhearted. That's the doctrine of Christ. Look at Luke chapter 4. That's God's will. He sent Christ to mend the people. And he showed it by, this guy been 38 years down, man. I'm finna heal him. You gonna challenge me about he carrying his bed on a Sabbath. And I told him to. I went in and told him one thing and tell him, make sure you live right. Because the worst thing can happen. So look at Luke 4 and verse 14. What does the text say? And Jesus returned into the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. And he taught in the synagogue, being glorified of all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. He grew up there. And his cups and walls, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Jesus went to church and participated in service. I admire all of you for participating in service. Serving, standing up before people. I was so scared to stand up before people. An old elder, Brother Kirby Jones, God bless him. He's passed on. He told me, son, if you're nervous, he said, go to your house and put some chairs out from your dining table and stand and talk. Do you know I did that and stood before four empty chairs and looked and read. And he said, look over the head so they don't scare you. I'm not going to forget that, brother. Somebody else might say, man, that's stupid. No. I was that gullible because I just wanted to know, man. I want to know how to do things right. Holy guys. I've been living holy longer than I've been alive. Been a crook all my life. I'm coming to God's people. I want to know what to do. I want to know how to function, you know. And so the idea is that it says here, he stood up to read, and that was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah through Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found a place where it was written. What if Jesus didn't know about the Bible? I know it's something here about Isaiah. Let me see. And that said, went right to it. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Now Isaiah wrote it before Jesus was born. He had sent me to heal the brokenhearted. See, that's his job, to preach deliverance to the captives. He sets you free from captivity. You thought you could never have another man again, because the first lousy husband you had whooped you, and you had to get a divorce just to live. And he never had a girlfriend, just crazy whooping people, drinking and whooping. That's all you ought to do. And they tell you, baby, you can't get married again because he's still single. That demon never going to get married again. He's a demon. He beats the other women and drinks too. But Jesus set you free and say, ask God to forgive you, give you strength, that you understood that you couldn't endure. Give you mercy to marry again. You can have peace in your life again. 1 Corinthians 7. You don't need to go no further. Nobody going to argue with these knucklehead brothers. They close the church up and want to try to tell you who you can marry. He don't even know how to unlock a door. And recovering a sight to the body, you blind, you cannot see. You cannot see that you need elders, deacons, and evangelists. So you don't have no training program. You cranking out preachers like a vending machine. Every time you turn around, you sending somebody to go preach somewhere. Sending somebody to go preach somewhere. Supplying church. And you don't have no elder or no deacon. Something wrong with you. We not stupid. You getting rid of them because you don't want none. You got a pattern, man. I saw that pattern. Yeah, I saw that pattern from brothers years ago. I said, oh, this is the pattern. First thing I want to do is get you to preach. Boy, they get you to preach. First thing out their mouth, I think he's going to be a preacher. You never hear him say, I think he'll be a good elder. You never hear that. I think he'll make a good deacon. Always, he's going to be a preacher because they know I'm getting you out of here as soon as I can. I heard a brother say it about me. He said, I got enough associate ministers. We got to get some of y'all out of here. We sending him somewhere to preach. I said, yeah, I know, because you don't want no leaders either. And he didn't have them either. And yes, it was Holly Nights. That's what we'll tell you. Isn't that sad? How long can you be blind before you get tired of hitting your kneecaps on stuff and open your eyes to set a limit to them that are bruised? Aren't you tired of getting bruised? Your leg is 6 different colors. Dark blue, light blue, brown because of the old one and healed up, bright red from the most recent injury, or walking with your eyes closed. And somebody say, baby, you don't have cancer. Why your legs are? Well, when I walk, they told me close my eyes because they'll tell me which way to go. I say, baby, don't do that. You're going to lose them legs after a while. You can't keep doing like that. Verse 19, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. I came to tell you this. I'm going to let you know when it's time that the church going to come. I'm going to tell you all that. And he calls the book and he sat. Watch what's going to happen. Again, to the minister, he gave it. And sat down, and the eyes of them were fastened on him in the synagogue. They looked at him. Ooh, this is a bad youngster here. Boy, this Jesus is tough. And he began to say to them, this day is the scripture fulfilled in your ears. And all bear witness and wondered of the gracious word of the seed out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? Oh, what a fine, strapping young gospel teacher. Until he started talking about truth. See, he read it. And now he's going to make the error in their mind of making application. And he said unto them, you will surely say unto me this proverb, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country. He said, y'all going to say that about me. Now first they're looking, boy, that's Joseph, boy, is it? Yeah, your dad was a carpenter. And he said, y'all going to say, heal yourself. Well, you hear that, boy? A small mom, don't you? You know what I'm gonna say, heal yourself. What's wrong with this boy? Uh-oh. It went south on him. And he said, truly I say unto you, no prophet except in his own country. He got a bad attitude. Nobody even said nothing to this boy. See, that's how people mind get things. I ain't said anything. That's how people mind get things like that. But I tell you the truth. Many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias. That's Elijah. When the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine was throughout all the land, but unto none of them was Elias sent. Uh-oh, he's stepping on toes now. See, that's the forefathers. You talk about people, daddy, they get mad. Watch what happened. Save unto Sarepta, a city of Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow. one bad story against your daddy and your mama before you. People back in the day. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Eliseus. Oh my goodness. Look at that. You see that? Elisha tagged them too. The prophet, and none of them was cleansed, saying, Naaman the Syrian, ouch, two foreigners, and one a ruler oppressing the land. He said, your forefathers were something else. They were too dirty to even clean. And he already tagged them. Remember, he said, you just like, why? Because y'all gonna tell me, heal yourself. Okay, it's time to fight now. Verse 28. And all day in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Isn't that amazing? They got the message, didn't they? Thought they couldn't understand the doctrine. Yeah, so he's talking about them. And sometimes he's talking about you and me. And rose up and thrust him out the city. Look at, threw him out the city. Drug him all, threw him out the city. And led him to the brow of the hill. Now they drug him, they're dragging him all the way out the city. Like you take him out of Humble. Take him over there to the dump. Where they got an edge. And take him there and throw Jesus in the dump. Throw him out the edge of the city. Throw him out the cliff. Where the city was built. That my cast now head on the, grab his legs and throw him here for him. Make sure we kill him. Now, do you all see this? Everybody got this? But he passed through the midst and then went his way. What a reception for a guy that just told you how to save your soul, how to change your life, how to get it right. Jesus said, I came to save the lost. Luke 19:10. We're almost done. Look at Luke 19:10. Why wouldn't he heal on the Sabbath? I came to save the lost. They got a problem with him. And then he gonna preach, talk about our daddies and our mamas. Man, they talking about us. My goodness, this guy's something else. He is. And he's not of sin. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which I came to get the lost folks. That's why I have to tell you, your dad and your mom was crooked and y'all crooked. Because y'all lost. You don't know my father. You had to deal with that group. I gotta tell you, you lost. I gotta uncover you. Luke 13:3. What happened? Well, Luke is whooping up on us with what Jesus said. Luke 13:3. I tell you, nay, but except you repent, you shall likewise perish. See, they had a saying going on about this group, verse 2. Jesus answered and said unto them, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all Galileans because they suffer such things. And what did they suffer? That was a group of Galileans, according to verse 1. He said they were present at the season. Some told them of Galileans whose blood potters mingled with their sacrifice. So now, they were sinners. Oh yeah. But Pilate took their blood and put it with his sacrifices to his God. And they thought, ooh, what a death. They must have been horrible. Jesus said, you think that was the worst sinners on earth? He said, you're going to die the same way. Wow. Unless you repent. Oh, I just talk small to my mama sometimes. You're going to die the same way. See, that's the problem. Because the Lord says you're going to die the same way. What else did he say? Verse number 4. He says, are those 18 upon whom the tower in Siloam fell and slew them? Think you that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? Because of time. Some people do that all the time. Girl, did you hear what happened to little Ned? Oh, man. His car got cut in half by a drunk driver. He was flung all the way and hit his head. He was still alive, rolled into the swimming pool and died. Ooh, child, God must have been after him. See, that's how we think. That's how we think. How I know? Because that's what they said about Paul when he got off the ship. It was cold. He was wet. He got some wood together. One piece of wood was a snake. Didn't realize it. Snake came out that bit him and said, surely this man is sought after by God. God's want to kill him. He got off a boat and they don't let him get bit. And they thought he was swell when he didn't swell. They said, oh, he is a God. They lost. So lost from one crazy idea to the next. Verse 5, I tell you, nay, but except you repent, you shall all like my parents. The Lord tell them, look, it don't matter what your crime, you don't repent of it, you're going to die. So I've come to heal, and there's no other way. Finally, God is a God of comfort. Last scripture concerning the message. Look at 2 Corinthians. Why would Jesus not tell us what's wrong with us and then tell us how to fix it? He is the God of comfort. 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 3. Blessed be God, even the Father of our mercy, of our Lord Jesus Christ, forgive me, the Father of mercies. He is the Father, the Creator of mercies, and the God of all come. He is the God of all kind of come. Have it come to you. Have it come to you. If you're on the corner begging for bread and somebody gave you a five, go get you a hamburger from Whataburger, God comforted you.
Amen.
You need to go to church, man. You need to change. Verse 4, who comfort us in all our tribulation. Why? That we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble. By the comfort of which we ourselves are comfort of God. Drug users are very unique sinner. Drug users are so unique. They try to paint like Quentin Tarantino a movie of exuberance. Of, you can't understand. You don't know what it's like to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning downtown Houston on Elgin with a needle in your arm. You don't know. You can't help me. I need somebody to be where I've been. Such an elaborate trick. You just want to clap. Well done, Bob. Well done. Give that man an Oscar. I can tell you how to stay out of hell because the Lord rescued me from being disrespectful to whatever you had. That's how you tell them. And I'm going to tell you because you're definitely on your way to hell. See, he wants to limit the playing field and narrow the teachers. And he's going to weed through them. So, what kind of drug you was on? He's going to check it out. If you want alcohol, you know there's a Narcotics Anonymous because they don't respect the Alcoholics Anonymous. Did you know that? Hey, man, alcohols, that's different, man. Even Everclear. Meth? Man, you ever been on meth? See, now you can't teach him. Okay, I've been an alcoholic for years and I can't. I'm sorry I don't have your designer drug sin. So he goes, you been on meth? Yeah. How many years? Well, you on heavy? You know, man, you need to get your raggedy life together. Quit trying to avoid hearing the truth. God is a God of comfort, and once he's comforted you in anything, got you out of trouble, you can help anybody in any trouble. And that's what we do. That's what Christ did, and that is what we do. You got to tell them like Jesus. When they get through with that story, tell them, say, do you want to get out of drugs? Just tell them just like that. After he go through his list like the man did, ask him again, do you want to get off drugs? Come on, let me sit down. Take this Bible and tell you what to do. You don't need to go on no mountain and walk barefoot and looking at ducks swimming. You need to come to church with me, hear the gospel, and get baptized. And you're gonna make it. See, that's the time. You know, some program. All kind of guys, boy, guys are lined up with stories. Man, you be like, man, this guy should write a book. And you got other people, and they hear the gospel. You know, I've been on drugs for years. I'm trying to get my life right. And saints need to stand down and hug them and love them and say, we're going to help you. We're going to help you. We're going to help you. You don't need grandma walking over there who thinks she's holier than Jesus. She got the left chair in heaven waiting on her, going up there over-criticizing. Because he said he went to jail because he beat his wife senseless. And because he was so high. And that's why he'd been in jail. Ooh, baby. You right. Go sit down, grandma. You can't help him. Go sit down. Go break some gingerbread. We got it. We're going to let him know. That's not the worst thing you could have done. We got other things. Got people with all kinds of sin. We're going to help you, man. So that's the idea. Because if you don't, he's going to be on the corner handing out false doctrine. With orange, bright orange on and a bottle of water. Come down here to the rehab, oh man, we're going to get you right. And he's going to send you straight to hell. That's what he's going to do. So you get him out the corner lying like he used to sell and use dope. Get him out the corner passing spiritual dope. Get him baptized in the Church of Christ. And then look here. Now, if you don't go on the corner, hand out these tracts here. And be ready to preach. And don't collect no money because you're not out there for that. You were trying to say so. That's what's wrong with these guys. You know, gonna look at you funny because you won't give no money. I'm not giving no organization money that's gonna teach you and others how to go to hell with that false information. Women preaching, people turning flips, more instruments than a doggone band got. Don't deal with that nonsense. They think they can reform. You're not reforming nothing. All you're doing is getting him set to go to hell. And he's going to remember you and be cursing and hating you all the time in hell for having led him in the wrong direction. Only you through Christ with the Holy Spirit and you can save. How's that done? You recognize you're lost? No, you're not safe. You might be near the kingdom, but you're not in. You believe Jesus died, was buried on the third day, rose again? You do well. The devils believe and tremble, but they don't obey. So now we got to get you to the obey stage. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4 is beautiful. But what you going to do about it? Mark 16:16, Jesus said, he that believe what? That and is baptized. Thank him. Say, somebody tell you, make me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You're going to have the jelly. They're going to tell you, I don't want it. Peanut butter and jelly. Good analogy. So repent and be baptized, and you shall see the Holy Ghost. So the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far. So it ties right in line with what Peter said. But Jesus said, he that believes not shall be damned. So as Peter preaches, he says you receive the Holy Spirit. He tells you all the pack. It's a package deal. It's beautiful. And you even get a book with it. Isn't that wonderful? It's a package deal. Salvation, sins removed, the Holy Spirit, and a book. All in a box. You get a house to live in, the church. Isn't that wonderful? Food to eat, the gospel. Water to drink, the spirit when you understand the word. Isn't that beautiful? Protection from criminals like Satan. They can't get back in unless you crack the door open. While Jesus trusts you, you open the door. Come on in, Satan. Just don't make no noise. You don't wake Jesus. When you let him back in, the demon, you got 7 more. He's going to whoop you silly. Nah. And the Lord gonna say, you let him in? Why you getting whooped? How you get beat up? You let him back in, didn't you? Like he told Adam, did you eat the fruit? Because the only way you would know something stupid like naked, you must have ate the fruit. It's like, why do we play with the Lord like that? I got me a boyfriend, man. We trying to make it. We bought us a car. He got him a car now. The Lord is good. We've been going to church, but you're not married. You're sleeping together. His uncle died, left him $50,000. God is so good. I scratched the lotto and won $60,000. And then he beat you down one day because he liked men and you didn't know that. And now you know, life is hard. Life is hard. No, see, if you'd have married him, maybe the Lord would have blessed you. With your heart saying you want to marry him, maybe the Lord would have said, okay, he's not good, so don't. Don't take him into your number. Take them in your heart. You'd be surprised why stuff go wrong for us. It would shock you. It would shock you. But you could go back and say, yeah, that's why I made my left turn. I should have been right. And the Lord had lights flash and everything. Come here, baby. And I waved at him and went left. Isn't that beautiful? I love you, Jesus. And holding my boyfriend's hand, I went left. And he got me. I said, listen. Peter said, for the promise unto you and your children and all that are far, even as men of the law of God shall call. Many other words he testified and encouraged. Save yourself, which means they were all lost, from this untoward, which means a crooked generation. He said, all the people around you are crooked. All the earth is crooked. We 120 are the only ones that are put together properly. Then they gladly received a word baptized the same day. 3,000 souls added unto him. They continued steadfast in the apostle doctrine, breaking the bread and prayer, and the Lord added to the church daily, such should be saved. But what did they continue on? Very important thing, fellowship. 1 John 1, to walk in the light as Christ in the light. Don't worry about the brethren around you, or your family, or your co-workers. Walk in the light as Christ in the light. Christ is going left. Grandpa say, I'm going to just sit here because I'm tired. Go around and keep going left. Your best friend say, hey man, go this way. Keep looking at Jesus, just go this way for a minute. I'm going to show you something. Keep walking, follow Jesus. The preacher say, baby, it's all about love. It's all about love. He get in a jet. He said, I'm fixing to take off. He finna get high. Say, I'm going left with Jesus. And you'll find you're safe. You're safe. It's a fact. The eunuch sees the water. He's been tossed away. He said, well, the enemy. Philip said, you believe with all your heart. Still something else. I believe Jesus Christ, Son of God. Stops baptized. He didn't say, I believe God will save me. No, I believe Jesus Christ, Son of God. Jesus said, you believe in God, believe also in me. So it's got to be me. That's what Jesus says. It's got to be him. Paul said, from one spirit are we all baptized into one body with a Jew, Gentile, bond of free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:13. There's no confusion. It says, 1 Peter 3, 21, the like figure went to even baptism is also now save us. Man, when I saw that scripture, I knew this is the one they can't lie about. Not to put any way to flip the flesh, but to answer the good conscience to our God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the dwelling in heaven, angels, authorities, and powers being made subject unto him. Verse 22. So you meet the people who've been baptized. Acts 19, 1 through 5 got you covered. What was the church doing? You were baptized, and well, yeah, we know we had banjos and all, baby. Don't say no more. That's not the Lord church. No. Well, we prayed at the mourner's bench. No such thing. You need to be baptized again. Well, can your wife baptize me? No, it's got to be me. So you a male shoulder? No, it's just we birthed them babies in the church. She birthed the babies on the earth. That's how it's done. Just can't handle that. It's a troublesome story. We have to accept. Father, Jesus said, both the devil should cast some of you in prison. We have tribulation 10 days. He said, be faithful to death. You got to be faithful. And you have everlasting life. If you believe that, you can be saved. Now you can be baptized. You call the number. Touch the triangle, please. It will show you several numbers. A couple of different congregations will direct you to someone who will baptize you. If you're here, though, you stay standing. And we sit down. But if you're here and you need prayer, I'm going to give you some advice from God. Fix it today because tomorrow is not promised. Why list today? But I got to go fix some things before I pray. No. Pray now and go fix the things later because you won't even get that far. Come now, all together we stand and sing Heaven's Invitation. As I am. Thank you, preacher. God.
Only but thy blood was shed for me. And that thy being
may be seated.
Become to me, O. Oh.